Yes, guys. So in IND-AS, we have a very, very interesting concept which we have to discuss is about something called as land and building. Now, when we were talking about IND-AS 16, somewhere we have discussed about land and building, but I said IND-AS 16 excludes something called as investment property, which is dealt as per a separate standard, that is IND-AS 40. Investment property. And I told you, if an enterprise is engaged in deriving lease income as their operating income, in such cases, we classify the land and building as your property, plant and equipment. But in any other case, if an enterprise is incidentally deriving a capital appreciation or a lease revenue, then in such situation, we'll have to classify it as investment property. Now, when we're looking at this word investment property out here, we have to explain what this investment property actually includes. Investment property includes, it is a property of land or building or part thereof, that means part of building, or a combination of both. So I'm saying investment property includes land, building or a part of building, or a combination of both. This can be called as your property, plant and equipment. Now, when we're talking about such kind of property, plant and equipment, either it can be owned by enterprise or, one more he has given, held by lessee under a finance lease. It can also be held under a finance lease. Either it can be owned or it can be held under finance lease. Both will come under the ambit of investment property itself. Along with that, we are also talking about one more kind of an instrument here. We are saying that it is held for rental or capital appreciation or both. We're saying that it can be held for rental or can be held for capital appreciation or for both. Look at the definition, how we are talking about. Investment property is a property of land or a building or a part thereof or a combination of both, held either by the enterprise or as a lessee under a finance lease with an intention to earn rental income or for capital appreciation or a combination of both. This entire thing put together can be called as investment property. Now, in this case, what we are saying is this investment property standard specifically excludes, number one, biological assets which are explained as per IND-AS 41 and mineral rights which are again discussed as per a specific standard, IND-AS 106. This is specific exclusions from the scope of the standard. Now, at the same time, when we are understanding what an investment property is, we'll have to see what exactly the investment property includes. Certain examples which I can give of investment property is I'm giving a few examples. I'm not saying that this is the only thing. These are few of the assets which can be called as investment property. First one, a vacant land held for undetermined. I haven't seen what I can use it for, but I will use it in the future. Undetermined future use. This is the first one. I am holding it as a vacant land. As of now, I don't know what purpose, but I will use it in the future. The second thing that we can talk about as investment property is land held for sale in short term, probably near future. Within 12 months, I want to sell it off. Such land, I can call it, I can hold it as investment property classified as IND AS 40. Number three, building which is leased out under operating lease. Or number four, building which is held with an intention, with an intention of letting out on operating lease in future. I haven't leased it yet, but I will lease it out in future, and that lease in future will also be only as operating lease. Property under construction. It is not yet constructed. It is under construction. To be held as investment property. In future. These are certain examples of investment property which are laid down in the standard IND AS 40. Let's understand what they are. We said investment property includes a land or a building or a part of the building or a combination of both. Either it can be owned by the enterprise or the enterprise is holding it under a finance lease as a lessee. It should be held for deriving rental income or for the purpose of capital appreciation or for both. Now we are trying to say that there could be a vacant land which you want to derive capital appreciation in a short term in future. Then such land will be called as investment property. Number two, a vacant land which I don't know what I want to use it for, I just kept it like that. I'm not using it any business purpose today. Such land will also be qualified or will be classified as investment property. A building which is let out on a finance lease, which is let out on an operating lease by the enterprise, or a building which is not let out but will be let out because my intention is to let it out on operating lease in future, or a property which is still under construction, it is not yet complete, but my intention is to use it as an investment property in future. That means I'm constructing a building, and the intention for me to construct the building is ultimately finish off the building, lease it out to someone else. If that is my intention, then that building which is under still under construction, I haven't leased it, but my intention is to make sure that I'll use it as an investment property in future. So in such cases, even though that building is under construction, I will still call it as investment property. These are certain examples which are given out in the standard. Got it? At the same time, the standard also said there are certain exclusions from the scope of the standard. Certain properties can never be called as investment property. What could be such kind of properties? Number one, such property, if it is occupied by the owner for a purpose of business, then you cannot call it as investment property. That is, owner occupied property cannot be classified as investment property. Number one. Number two, any asset with which you want to derive some economic benefit, either it is used in the process of production or for provision of services, excluded from the scope. Number three, I am holding it for the purpose of sale as inventory. I'm saying I am holding it with an intention to sell it as inventory. Then in such case, I am basically a real estate developer or a construction agent. Then for me, it is classified as AS2 inventory, should not be used as per IND AS 40. Then moving further, administrative assets. I have a leasehold, I have a premises which I own. I have given it to my employees as rent-free accommodation. Then even such assets will fall outside the scope of the standard. I am constructing a building, but that is a construction contract for me. That building does not belong to me. I'm constructing the building under a construction contract, so I will not have any right over that. That will not be classified under IND AS 40, should be classified as per the relevant standard of construction contracts. Got it? So this way we can understand the differentiation between what an investment property is and what is not an investment property. Clear? Yes guys, so we are understanding investment property. So investment property excludes, we have seen the inclusions, so let us see the exclusions then. The exclusions from investment property are basically those which are held as inventory for the purpose of sale in ordinary course of business. Held for sale in ordinary course of business. That means I'm talking about something called as inventory, which is covered as per a specific standard in IND AS 2. That means what we are talking about here is about such kind of property plan, investment property, that is building or a land or a part of a building or combination of both, which is basically held for the purpose of being sold in the ordinary course of business. So I'm referring to such companies where the building becomes an ordinary course of business inventory, which is nothing but a construction company or a real estate company. Let's talk about the second one now. The second one is basically held as construction contract for others. It is a construction contract, but you are holding it for others, specifically dealt as per IND AS 11, now being merged into IND AS 15. This is one more. That means it is a building under construction, but such building under construction is not your investment property, but it is an investment property of someone else. Held for use in process of production or provision of services. Anything which is used in the process of production or provision of services will be covered as per IND AS 16. It is a land, it is a building, but it is used for in the process of production or provision of services. That means basically I'm talking about a factory land. I'm talking about an office building. Such things, they are held for process of production or provision of services to be covered under IND AS 16. Held for administration purpose. Administrative purpose basically simply means that I am talking about such kind of investment property, that is land and building or a part of a building thereof or a combination of both, which is held for an administrative building of the enterprise, or held as rent-free accommodation which is given to the employees. All such kind of purposes which will be called as administrative purpose will be excluded from the scope of the standard. These are four exclusions which he has given specifically as per Ind AS 40. Guys, the problem does not normally arise like this. In a general situation, what happens? I have a building. Now there are, let's say, three floors. These two floors are basically self-occupied. I'm occupying it for the purpose of my own premises, while this one I've held it for the purpose of lease or for the purpose of capital appreciation. Now look at this concept now. Now these are combination of assets. Now there is a combination which is happening here when one particular asset is used for multiple purposes, where the investment property is held for multiple purposes. When an investment property is held for multiple purposes, in such situation, what are we supposed to do? It's a land and building, which is basically, I'm referring to this as a building. A building has three floors. We are saying that one and two are being self-occupied. The third floor is being held for capital appreciation of lease or lease. Now, whenever we have this situation, we'll have to see whether the asset is separable or not. Separable. When I use this word separable, what does it even indicate? How do I say that an investment property in this situation, where it can be held for more than one purpose, can be called as separable? It can be called as separable if it can be sold or leased out in part separately. So if you can actually sell it or lease out a part of that separately, then in such situation we can ensure that an investment property, even though it is of multiple purposes, we can separate. For example, let's say I have a store in which I'm doing a restaurant business. A small corner of that particular place, I have given it to a pan place. A person who is actually manufacturing pan or making pan out there, I've given him a small place where he can use. Now that place which I've given him, I'm making sure that I'm collecting some rental on the basis of his business he does or on a fixed basis. I have to see whether it falls under the separability criteria or not. Can I separate only that particular place? Not possible, because it is within the same premises. Can I lease out only that particular place? Not possible, because that is within the same premises. I cannot enmark or I cannot demark that particular place. When I cannot demark that particular place, it becomes very difficult for us to separate it. Whenever it becomes separable, to the extent it was self-occupied, then we have to cover it as per Ind AS 16. To an extent, it was held as lease to others. Then in such situation, I'll classify it under Ind AS 40 as investment property. This is a situation where I have a separability situation coming up. I'm saying that the asset is separable only if the asset can be sold or can be leased out in part. That means a part of that can be done separately. If it is inseparable, you cannot separate it like that. When you say that it is inseparable, that means you cannot separate the portions at all, though it includes two different portions, then we will say that identify which one is more significant. If self-occupied portion is more significant then we will classify it as, if the answer is yes, then I'll classify it as IND AS 16. However, if your answer is no, self-occupied is not significant, then I'll classify it as investment property under IND AS 40. When we use the word significant in general sense can always indicate anything greater than 20%. This in general sense can be called as significance. So where I'm saying that I'm holding it for multiple purpose, but to an extent it has been leased out, to an extent it is self-occupied, but the self-occupied part is more significant than the other, then we will call it as IND AS 16 asset, that is property, plant and equipment. Where I say that I am occupying only a small part, the majority of the component is being used as an investment property, as a let out asset, in such cases I'll use it as IND AS 40. Remember guys, such lease should always be out of finance lease, so only out of operating lease. If I have given it on operating lease, then it is my asset. If I have given it on finance lease, then in my books I'll have to derecognize the asset as per IND AS 23, which we have already seen. This in context is what we can discuss about investment property exclusions and where an investment property is held for multiple purposes. It is one single property, but I'm using it for multiple purposes than what we are supposed to do. So these are two different things that we have to combine and we have to understand. Now, we'll also have to see that sometimes along with the lease, we also provide some extra service. What services do we provide? And what is the treatment when there is an extra service being provided along with the lease? I'm not just leasing the asset, but I'm also providing something called as ancillary services. Ancillary services means attached to leasing, I'm doing something more. Then in such situation, how do I treat the amount of income? Let us see that. Yes, guys, I was talking about something called as ancillary services. What are these ancillary services? Some sort of service which I am providing along with leasing out an asset. I'm terming these as ancillary services. Now, what normally these services are? Sometimes I can provide a housekeeping service along with the rental. I'm providing a premises on rent, as well as I'm saying that for you, along with this particular service, I am providing you extra service that is regarding housekeeping. Now, very regular this is that I'll provide you free Wi-Fi facility. I'll provide you the entire furniture together. Now, all these services put together, would they influence the pricing of that particular product? That is a question. Sometimes there could also be a service where we are talking about, let's say I'll provide you water service. Now, water service will not significantly differ my pricing. At the same time, I'll make sure that the watchman is being provided. Now, these are normal facilities which would normally do not influence the pricing of that particular investment property then. So that's why your ancillary services regarding your investment property, whenever you're leasing out an asset on operating lease, along with operating lease, I am providing certain ancillary services. In such case, we will have to observe whether such service is significant or not. If it is significant, then we have a specific treatment. It is significant. What does significant mean? Significant means it influences the price of a set. Then I can say that it is significant ancillary services being provided. Whenever it is significant, then it is covered under IND AS 16. It is not covered under IND AS 40 anymore. It will be covered under IND AS 16. Now, if you want me to name a few examples of such particular service where it is predominant or significant in actually the service, then I can call it as probably your housekeeping services, free Wi-Fi, etc. A reception is being provided, a conference room being provided which can be let out. Now all these particular services, we can call them as significant services. Now along with this significant services, there is also sometimes an insignificant portion which will exist. Whenever I say such services are insignificant, that means they do not influence the price of the property, plant and equipment or lease or your investment property by any chance, then we will say that it is covered under IND AS 40. It does not influence the price of the investment property. Now if you want to give me certain examples which under this, then I can include water facility. I can also provide security guards. I cannot really say security guard always does not influence the pricing, but you can take it as an example. So these are particular things which we have to understand along with auxiliary service. So whenever there's an auxiliary service, observe whether that service is significant or not. If it is significant, or if you believe that it is significant, then cover it as per IND AS 16, that is property, plant and equipment. If it is insignificant, then I cover it as per IND AS 40, that is property, plant and equipment. Now along with this will actually end us the concept of what a property, plant and equipment is and how the classification of a particular property to be done as per IND AS 16 or IND AS 40. But along with that, we'll also have to understand what is a recognition criteria. The criteria for recognition of investment property. Whenever I talk about recognition criteria of investment property, understand investment property is very similar to your property, plant and equipment. How different is it? It is only difference in the facility in which you want to basically use that asset. I want to use it as leasing out to others as operating lease. I want to use it for capital appreciation purpose. It is your use which is making it being classified as investment property instead of property, plant and equipment. So your recognition criteria is predominantly the same. So this becomes very, very similar to IND AS 16. Let me repeat what we have learned in IND AS 16 as recognition criteria. First one was it should be within the control of enterprise. When I say within the control of enterprise, control indicates you can either restrict access or grant access to that particular asset. Number two, future economic benefits are probable to arise. Future economic benefits could be either in the form of increased revenue, reduced cost, ease of use, but it is probable. Probable means you need not quantify the benefit or determine the timing of the benefit. You need not quantify the amount of benefit that you get, or you need not determine the timing of the benefit that is going to arise. Number C, the cost should be reliably measured. Sometimes where the cost cannot be reliably measured, then we will cannot recognize the property. So this we will understand in our measurement principles. More about measurement principles we'll learn further in the standard, but this is predominantly discussed as a part of measurement principle. So I'm saying recognition of a property, plant and equipment should be done only if it is within the control of an enterprise. The enterprise derives an economic benefit from the use of the asset or from the sale of the asset. And third one, the cost of the asset can be reliably measured. If these conditions are satisfied, we can recognize an asset under investment property that is under Ind AS 40. This is my recognition criteria, which is very similar to what we have learned as a part of Ind AS 16. We have learned this as a part of Ind AS 16, property, plant and equipment. Even the measurement criteria to an extent becomes very similar. To an extent is almost very similar, except for one or two changes which we will have to concentrate upon. Otherwise, the measurement criteria is predominantly very much the same. We will have to discuss about the concepts of measurement related to Ind AS 40. So we will name this as measurement principles of investment property. When we're talking about these measurement principles, the first thing that you need to understand that is predominantly very similar to what we see as far as Ind AS 16 is concerned. So here we talk about measurement principles for separate acquisition also for exchange of assets also regarding acquisition through finance leases. Three types of acquisition that we have to understand when we're talking about measurement principles. Now, three acquisitions. The first one, when we're talking about separate acquisition, the separate acquisition part we have to understand with relation to what we have learned in Ind AS 16, property, plant and equipment. What did we learn there? Separate acquisition will include cost of purchase plus cost incurred to bring the inventory or to bring the asset to the condition and location in which management intends to operate the asset. Plus estimated cost of dismantling. Dismantling and site restoration and removal. Three parts of cost that we have to understand with respect to separate acquisition: cost of purchase plus cost incurred to bring the inventory to bring the asset to its current location and condition plus estimated cost of dismantling, site restoration and removal of the goods. Now all these costs put together will give me what is the cost of separate acquisition, and this is what we have in depth explained even under the concept of Ind AS 16, property, plant and equipment. Now let's talk about exchange of assets then. When we have exchange of assets, always should be recognized at fair value. Unless, number one, the transaction lacks physical substance. Transaction lacks commercial substance. Commercial substance. Or number two, fair value cannot be determined reliably. Cannot be reliably measured. It's the same concept that we have learnt even as per IND AS 16. Same concepts that we are trying to revise again as far as IND AS 40 is concerned. Finance lease, we did not learn in IND AS 16, but we have learnt it as far as IND AS 17 was concerned. Now here, if you have acquired an asset on finance lease, you become the lessee. When we are the lessee, as far as IND AS 17 was concerned, the asset should be recognized at lower of, number one, fair value of the asset, or number two, present value of minimum lease payments from the standpoint of lessee. This is what was stipulated as far as IND AS 17 was concerned. Now this is very similar to what we have learnt as a part of IND AS 16 or IND AS 17. So nothing predominantly different that we are trying to look at when we are emphasizing on IND AS 40 measurement principles of investment property. Now along with that, a very similar paragraph which I have already taken was acquisition under deferred credit terms. Whenever we have deferred credit terms of acquisition, in such cases, what was the accounting treatment that we have actually emphasized upon? Whenever we have deferred credit terms, we always said that assume that the transaction first occurred at a price under normal credit terms. So the actual purchase price minus normal credit terms purchase will give you the finance cost. So that means asset should be recognized at a price negotiated under normal credit terms. And the finance cost component in this value should be given as the transaction price, the price at which you entered the transaction, minus the price under normal credit terms. This is what we have understood as far as acquisition under deferred credit terms is concerned. We identify a finance cost. Such finance cost should be dealt as per IND AS 23, that is borrowing cost. This is what we have understood and emphasized under deferred credit terms even as per IND AS 16, the same thing being emphasized even as per IND AS 40 as well. The other component or other very important substance is regarding subsequent cost. When we emphasize on this word subsequent cost, we have to understand that we have seen something called as component basis of accounting or component basis of recognition. Now this component basis of recognition and the subsequent cost are very similar as per IND AS 16. We have seen this in depth, including certain examples that we have taken. So it is very much the same component accounting and the subsequent measurement or subsequent cost that we have to even recognize as per IND AS 40. There's no something different which is happening out in your measurement principle, because predominantly your measurement principle have been borrowed from IND AS 60 into your IND AS 40. There's no significant differences which actually would appear from what we have discussed in the earlier standards. So this standard regarding your measurement principle becomes very simple, and the same was even with respect to your recognition principle, because even your recognition emphasized absolutely the same thing. Got it? Yes, guys. So we were talking about investment property for measurement of cost, and we have seen the initial recognition. But when we're talking about subsequent recognition, a slight difference or deviation will be observed from IND AS 16. In subsequent recognition, when we're talking about the small deviation from what we have learned in IND AS 16. What is the deviation which I'm talking about? If you remember, subsequent recognition under IND AS 16 has proposed two models. One which is costless cost model, other one being called as a revaluation model. Revaluation model uses the fair value of assets and liabilities. It uses a fair valuation of the asset and will keep measuring the asset at its fair value on each balance sheet date. While under cost model, we always continue using an original cost reduced by the amount of accumulated depreciation also the amount of accumulated impairment loss. This is what is proposed under cost model, while revaluation model considers the fair value. Here, one thing that you have to understand is that the IND AS 16 or the IND AS 40 has not recommended the revaluation model. So what is accepted as far as your IND AS 40 is concerned is only your cost model. There is no revaluation model which has been emphasized as per the standard IND AS 40. However, fair value should be identified and disclosed in the financial statements. Remember, guys, compulsory we have to check for the fair value, and it has to be disclosed in the financial statements. I'm not asking you to remeasure your asset, but I'm asking you only to disclose the amount of fair value on each balance sheet date. The standard says that the fair valuation by an independent valuer is encouraged. Independent valuer, this word here, independent valuer, in a sense indicates I am talking about a person who is called a chartered engineer. He is an appropriate person to take care of the independent valuation of an investment property. So this in a sense is the subsequent recognition of a property, plant and equipment. So we'll have to adopt only a cost model, and such cost model which we have understood here prescribes only the original cost reduced by the accumulated depreciation and accumulated impairment losses. The fair valuation has to be identified on each balance sheet date and should only be disclosed in your financial statements, and such fair valuation should be done by an independent valuer which is encouraged in the standard. I never said it has to be done compulsory like this, but it should be encouraged is the terminology which is used in the standard. Now, after subsequent recognition, we'll have to observe something called as derecognition of investment property. There are two ways of identifying or derecognizing an asset. What are those two things that we are talking about here? when we talk about derecognition, we'll have to understand that derecognition can happen in two ways. One on disposal, the other one at the end of the useful life. Sometimes an asset can be, the investment property can be acquired on finance lease. At the end of the lease term, the useful life is completed. So you will automatically have to derecognize the asset. However, when we are talking about disposal, the disposal can happen predominantly by two ways. What are the two ways of disposal? One way is by sale. Sale of investment property is one of the way of disposal of asset. The other one is when you lease out the investment property under a finance lease. Lease which constitutes to finance lease. A lease which will constitute to a finance lease. These are the two ways of disposal that we observe. When we are looking at these two different ways of disposal, let us understand that at the time of sale, whatever profit or loss on sale that arises should be recognized in P&L immediately. While when we are talking about lease under which constitutes a finance lease, we'll say that the profit or loss should be recognized over the lease term. If I have given the lease for 10 years and over the entire period of 10 years, I'll recognize the profit or loss into the P&L. So these are two different ways of recognition of profit or loss that happens. Here immediately, here it should be recognized over the lease term. So these are the two ways of derecognition of an investment property. So this, in a sense, is what we can understand in investment property, that is Ind AS 40. Ind AS 40 is predominantly talking about investment property. It defines an investment property, also tells what does not constitute to an investment property, and excludes biological assets and mineral rights from the scope of the standard. So we have seen what could be the situation when there is auxiliary service, when there is a combination of different functions which is run by a building. It can be self-occupied, it can be let out in a portion, or sometimes the recognition of the asset and also their initial and subsequent measurement of cost. At the same time, we are also looking at the derecognition and saying that at the time of derecognition, if your derecognition is by sale, recognize it immediately. If it is by leasing out through a finance lease, then we'll have to recognize the profit or loss over the lease term into the P&L. So this, in a sense, will end our discussion on Ind AS 40.